Good evening, everyone. I want to thank everyone for coming here tonight for our commissioners' meeting. First thing that we want to do is start with the Pledge of Allegiance. So let's all stand and raise the flag and say Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Now we go to our item of our roll call, and Tricia will help us with that.
Okay, Commissioner Fong.
Here.
Commissioner Esquerdo. Commissioner Martinez.
Here.
Commissioner Camacho.
Here.
Commissioner De La Rosa.
Here.
Commissioner Lisa Hola.
Here.
Okay. And Commissioner Ramirez. Okay.
Thank you. Now we'll come to our public comments. Do we have any public comments? We have one. Councilman.
No, just Anthony. Hi, my name is Anthony Rocha. I wanted to stop by and say hello to everyone who's here and thank you for being here in person. We came through a crazy year and I'm so happy that we have our commissioners here in person, willing to continue to participate and contribute to our community. This is one of the commissions where I started off, and I have always felt that Library and Community Services Commission is one of the most important commissions for our city. So I want to thank you for your service. I spoke to my commissioner just a minute ago, so I'm guessing she's running late, but I wanted to thank all of you for being here. That's all.
Thank you, Councilman Anthony Rocha. And now we'll go to our consent item, and it's our minute from June 9th. Commissioners, have you had a chance to review the minutes? And if so, could I have someone, one of the commissioners, make a motion to pass the minutes of June 9th?
I'd like to make a motion to pass the minutes.
Commissioner Joey Martinez, motion. Commissioner Gloria De La Rosa, second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Minutes pass. And now we come to our item of consideration, and this is the election of the chair and vice chair, and we do this every year. And the chair can only serve for two consecutive term, which is 2 years. And we can begin by having nominations. Do I hear any nominations from our commissioners for election of the chairman?
I would like to nominate Gloria.
We have Gloria De La Rosa nominated. Do I hear a second?
A second.
We have a second. All in favor say aye.
Yeah. Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Can I say aye?
Do we have any other nomination for the chairman position? Not hearing any, we congratulate Commissioner Gloria De La Rosa as our new chair.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, I'll just continue with the election of the vice chair. Do I hear a nomination for the position of vice chair?
I nominate Liz.
We have a nomination for Liz Camacho for vice chair. Do we hear a second?
Oh, second.
Commissioner Joey Martinez, second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
So we have nomination for the vice chair.
I have and Gloria all in favor say aye. Here.
So we did that. Okay. So we have a vice chair and chair. Now I'd like to turn the chairman's position to our new chairwoman, Gloria De La Rosa.
Thank you very much, and we're going to move on to, we already did public comments, and we did, I believe, general, so we're going to move on to our administrative report, which is summer programming presentation.
Thank you, commissioners. I'm really excited to have our team here today to present to you on the creative things that we did over the summer. I can't say enough about the innovation and the creativity that the Library and Community Services staff has shown over the last year and a half. It's been a very difficult year, but they were up to the challenge and they've done some really great stuff. So we're gonna go ahead and call up the library first. Ernesto Lizaola, our community service manager, let's start with you and then we'll move on to the rec and community services side of the house.
Hello, good evening, commissioners. My name is Ernesto Lizaola. I'm the community education manager for the Salinas Public Library. And I will be talking a little bit about our summer reading challenge, our summer programming, which is a staple of our library services every year. And like any other, we try to make the best of it and try to offer good community programs for our residents. All right, there we go. So every year there's a national organization that focuses on trying to identify themes for our summer programming. This year's theme was called Reading Colors Your World, and certainly we needed a lot of color this year and the summer, so we try to do the best we can to fit that theme into our summer, not only just in color, but in the type of variety of programs that we offered for the various residents that we have. And our summer program ran from June 14th through July 31st. So it's a 7-week program, as it is most years. All right. So here were some of our main goals this summer. We knew that youth and adults went through a very new academic year. So really our focus was trying to make our summer reading fun and engaging. We always want to promote the habit of reading every day, so that was a key element of our programming. We wanted youth to be engaged in learning opportunities, but learning that was really fun and engaging and something that piqued their interest. And as always, we try to reduce that summer slide, which is a documented phenomenon that students lose up to a full grade level of various subjects throughout the summer if they don't practice reading, math, language, et cetera. And then ultimately, we want to help build those libraries that youth and adults have at home by giving away free book prizes. So these were the types of programs that we offered. Again, we have a lot of constituents. We have youth, we have parents, we have teens, we have adults, and everyone wants a part of the summer, right? So we try to have a balanced approach, not only in the types of services that we offer, but reaching different populations. So we try to focus on take-home kits, which were very popular and were convenient. And given that there were still some safety concerns from families, it was an easy way for youth and adults to come to the library, pick up materials, and then complete them at home, either with instructional videos provided by our staff or by instructions printed that were included in the kits. We also had a graphic novel contest, which I'll talk a little bit more in the slides. We had story time at the park. We had a nutrition series for youth. In the past, we've had nutrition series for adults, and we heard from parents that they wanted one for their kids, so we introduced that in a partnership with Catholic Charities. We had an intro to coding with Ozobots. So these are kind of little Ozobot coding electronics that you can code by using lines and patterns. And it's the whole idea of if this, then that. So it's a very elementary approach to coding. We had art exploration. So arts programs are always very popular during the summer. It's something that it's accessible to everyone and anyone at whatever talent they have. So we offered some of those. We had a tech build challenge, which was a partnership with the Tech Museum from San Jose. They would Zoom with our library staff and offer building challenges for youth. We also offered book lists, and I'll talk about the Kinder Boot Camp, which is something that we've offered over the last 4 years as well. And then we offered a lot of on-demand programming through different service providers so that programs were accessible to youth and adults whenever they were ready for them. Those would be online. They could access them at any time throughout the summer. So overall, this was our program attendance. We had 1,471 actual attendees for various programs, and that included 532 attendees for in-person programs, which were primarily story time and our Kinder Boot Camp programs. and then virtual attendance of 939. In addition to that, we distributed 1,834 kits that were distributed at all three of our library branches for youth and adults. As part of our reading challenge, which promotes the actual reading part of the summer, we had 731 participants for that program, and we had over 700 books that were given away as part of prizes for reading during the summer. And then we also served lunch and snack at the Cesar Chavez Library. So we served over 2,000 meals in less than 2 months. So I'd like to highlight a few of the programs that I thought really stood out. This was one of our two in-person programs. It was Storytime at the Park. We had a total of 468 attendees during six events. And we try to have these spread out throughout the city of Salinas so that different communities will have access to it. We hosted two at Central Park, two events at El Dorado Park, and then two events at Natividad Creek Park. And for these, we start out with a group of 32, I believe, for the first one, and we had a peak of close to 100 attendees for one of the events. So we knew they were very popular, and as we spoke to parents and families, they're really interested in that in-person activity just because they've been cooped up for so long. This was part of our virtual on-demand programs. It's a service provided by an organization called Page Turner, and we offered stories, shows, follow-on crafts, arts, author visits, virtual field trips, and all of these services, one, were available throughout the summer whenever patrons, residents wanted to access them, they could. But also it helped alleviate some programming from our staff. These were done by professionals that provide services to other library services. So that allowed us to do the more in-person and intimate programming with and public service within our libraries as well. We did have a graphic novel contest, which is something that we've done in years past. Sometimes we've done it with the summer programs, other times we've done it in coordination with Comic-Con or other related events. And it's really a way to promoting arts and language and writing at the same time. So we opened this contest, and it included the virtual interviews with different published authors and artists and graphic novelists who shared about their experience, how they got started, but also how they go about creating a story. So we offered three workshops to get attendees ready for that, I mean, participants ready for that. In total, we received 13 entries, and winners received various prizes, including art supplies, toy figurines, et cetera. And some of the winning publications will be published into a book that we'll share with the winners and possibly add to our collection one way or another. All right, so here's a representation of some of the kits that we distributed this summer. As I mentioned, we distributed over 1,800 kits at all sites. It included weekly kits for youth, so every single week we had a different kit for youth, and then three kits for adults. I think out of everything, the adults were really wanting those kits. Some of those were gone in the first 5 minutes. We knew it was gonna be something that families wanted either for traveling or for doing at their own time. So it proved to be very popular and something that will likely continue into the future, including more things for adults. Some of the ones that we included for adults were a paint night, and we had a succulent kit, which included different tools and things to plan your own and grow your own succulents, and then a journal, a journal. Towards the end of the summer, as we've done in previous years, we always try to do what we can to get kids kinder ready. And so something that we did this year was not necessarily with partner schools, but we ended up hosting the kinder boot camps within our library sites just because of accessibility to those sites. So this was an in-person program. We had 2 weeks available for two different communities in a way. One structured right before the Alisaw Elementary School District began, another one right before the Salinas City Elementary School started as well. So we had a total of 17 participants. And the goal of this is really to prepare, especially those kids who haven't had any preschool experience in the past, learning the routines of what it's like to go into school, lining up, keeping your hands to yourself, sitting down, raising your hand, et cetera. So it's not necessarily teaching them the essentials, but getting them ready to learn when they start school. And we always do this towards the end of the summer so that, you know, they're ready to go from the boot camp into the classroom and they have all this information fresh in their mind and kind of keeping those routines going. And part of these boot camps, we gave away free backpacks and school supplies to every participant as well. And we've been lucky enough to get funding for this boot camp for the last 4 years, and we'll continue to look for it into the future as well. And so this is just a few images of our summer reading challenge. As I mentioned, we had 731 participants. We gave away 728 books, and we'll probably give away a few more since the redemption deadline for the books is until this coming Friday. So likely that number will increase. And we have a way for participants to track their reading both online and in person with paper reading logs. Something we learned in years past is that physical presence and those reading logs really help and drive participation, and it drives people to our library, and it proved to be that it was essential. So this, which we probably never do fully online because people and youth really like the experience of coming to the library, getting book recommendations, getting those checked off, and picking their own books. And lastly, we continue to partner with the Alisaw Union School District, Alisaw Elementary School District, to serve lunches to our residents near or anywhere, but located at Cesar Chavez. And we gave away over 2,000 lunches and snacks that were to go this year. We noticed there was a big uptick in July after students were out from summer school. So we know it's a big need that a lot of youth get their lunch, their meal at school. And when they're out of school, they appreciate having that extra help for lunches beyond that. And that's all I got. Are we doing questions now or at the end? Okay. Are there any questions? Comments?
I have a question.
Hmm?
Do you have a question?
Okay. I apologize for not turning on my mic. Very good presentation. The city's doing a wonderful job reaching out to our community. And I want to give kudos to all of you, the staff. My only one question is going back to story time at the park. Mm-hmm. I think that's great. How did you come up to just pick three parks? And why were these three picked? Instead of
We thought about it. We really looked at the facilities of where can we have a large enough space to fit a big group, because we knew we wanted social distancing and we wanted to be open to as many as we can receive. Mm-hmm. Also, we want to spread out throughout communities so that there were parks that were easily accessible either through short commute or walking distance. Mm-hmm. And then spreading them. But part of it also was having that routine of if families missed one date, they'd be able to remember that second date and come back. So, you know, we'd wish we could do more parks, but that's kind of what we felt that was a good kind of representation of where different parks are located throughout the city and try to capture as many of those local residents as possible.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for that response. Does anyone else have any questions? Any other commissioners? Commissioner Martinez.
Thank you for the presentation, and thank you for keeping the programs going during this whole situation. I would like to know, where can we find is there a list of the partners that were partnered with these programs, partners and service providers?
We do have a list. We don't have a comprehensive list yet of thank yous of everyone who participated, but they are credited within the promotion when the program was promoted. So the tech Catholic Charities, all the other organizations that were part of the service. And I'd be happy to share that with you all if you like that list.
Yes, please, okay. Please, because I would definitely like to address them too at some point. They're very, you know, they're great organizations, and they're helping to do a good thing, which is serve our community. So I would thank you for that.
Sounds great.
I have two kids under five, and I kept them busy through these programs, so I want to say thank you. They really made use. I live right next to Nativity Creek Park. They wanted to go to Story in the Park, and that's the only event that we probably didn't get to go, but they took advantage of the take-home kids, mm-hmm. everything. And the only thing is, I need more things for adults because it left me wanting to do activities too, like journaling and things like that. I mean, we did the reading challenge, but it made me like maybe journaling in the park for adults for own mental health. But yeah, they loved it, so thank you.
And we always heard that feedback. Adults like fun stuff too. It's not just the literacy class and all that. So we noted that.
Is there any other commissioner that has?
Ramirez. So I want to start off by saying that I honestly think that this program is actually a very great program for the community and for the younger generation. However, I am seeing a lack in the teen portion. I do recognize that you have a lot of things going on for the elementary schools and stuff mm-hmm. like that, but the teens are also the youth as well. And so it would be great to see a little bit more of that as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
A very good point. Commissioner Fong?
I just also want to thank you for all the programs that all the UNESCO and all the city staff people are providing for our community. It's really a great service. And I love seeing all this stuff. And I also want to be thankful that we have a full board of commissioners. I've been here 8 years. And this is about the fullest we've had in that's really great.
Thank you.
Sorry, I didn't have my mic on, but I think you guys can hear me. Thank you for all being here.
Thank you.
All right. Is there anyone else, any of the other commissioners that want to make a comment or no? Or a question? Seeing no one? We'll move on to our next presentation, which is summer programming, recreation and community service. Vivian.
Good evening, commissioners. Tonight, I'll be presenting on summer programming with Jose. We'll be speaking about our recreation and park division programs and community safety programs. So this summer, we offered our first in-person outdoor summer recreation program. We offered this program at four locations, El Dorado Park, Red Rocks Recreation Center, Central Park, and the Firehouse Recreation Center. We kind of did it different this year. We offered a 2-3 week sessions at each of the locations. Our first session went from June 21st through July 9th, took a week off to kind of prepare for the second session, which went from July 19th through August 6th. We focused on ages 7 through 12 year olds, and we did a variety of outdoor recreation activities. We did arts and crafts, we did a variety of sports. As you can see here, our youth, this photo is at Central Park, and this is actually on the tennis courts, and we used it for, you know, an outdoor volleyball game for us. And so we used the different locations or the areas throughout the parks or the facilities to do a variety of programming. And so, and actually all our kids who participated in the program, they really enjoyed it, looking forward to what we got coming in the future. We had a total of 120 registered participants, 60 in each session in total. We also provided lunch, which the LSL Union School District provided. We always work with them every summer. And so we specifically provided lunch for each of our participants, which was at a free cost. We also followed COVID-19 guidance, which was the K-12 guidance and a cohort model, just to ensure that we kept the safety for all participants and staff. Another program we did this summer, we did our summer kit distributions. We've been doing this throughout the year, but this in the summer it gets a little it's a little different for us. We focus on doing kit distribution every week. We actually did it for seven weeks. Every week was a themed activity, so you know we focused on Ocean Week, Fourth of July Week, how do you make that week. So we had a variety of different themed weeks. We did our distribution every Friday from 3:30 to 4:30. It was free. You just had to come to one of the six locations. So we had it at El Dorado Park, Central Park, Breadbox, Firehouse, El Dorado, and Hebron. And we distributed 2,800 kits. In total, staff created over 14,000 individual activities because every activity we distributed 400 bags every week. So in total, you know, staff created a lot of activity bags, and so I'm really proud of them that we were able to produce so much in such a short period of time. We also did a summer conditioning camp. We did this camp in two sessions. June 21st through July 2nd was our first camp, was held at Hartnell Park. Here we focused on basketball and flag football. We focused on two age groups. The first one was 8 to 10-year-olds, and then the second one was 11 to 13. And then our second session focused on basketball and soccer, and where the kids came in, our participants came in, and they learned the fundamentals of each sport. We did basketball twice because that's a very popular sport for us, and we always see the high request in basketball, so we offered it twice, that particular sport. In total, we had 64 registered participants for this program, combined, I should say. First time we kept to a small cohort model, and then the second time we opened it up to add on a little bit more to our sports camp. And then I'm gonna pass it off to Jose.
Thank you, Vivian. Good afternoon, commissioners. Jose Arriola with Community Engagement and Partnerships Division is the name of it, formerly Community Safety Division. And normally I'd be up here talking to you about two wonderful team programs we have that focus on high school youth, which would be our Youth and Government Institute and our Youth Leadership Academy. However, because of COVID, we weren't able to launch those programs. Both take a lot of recruitment in the spring. We work very closely with high schools, and not knowing the status of reopening, we weren't able to launch those. And I look forward to bringing those back because they're very popular programs and I think do a lot of good in terms of giving access to our teen population to city, to learning about the city and how it works, as well as getting an opportunity to do internships within many of our nonprofit agencies throughout the city of Salinas. So to Kristen's point about being creative, we got our heads together and said, what could we offer now that we know we can start to serve kids? And we came up with the Community Service Camp Amor Salinas. We took an opportunity to really use the marketing of a brand new initiative in the city called Amor Salinas, an effort to clean up Salinas, educate youth about not littering, giving youth and residents an opportunity to come out and clean and support them in doing that and beautifying their neighborhoods. And we did this, we offered this community service camp because we knew there was pent-up demand for high school students who needed community service hours to graduate. And they hadn't gotten those opportunities in the, you know, 18 to 20 months of the pandemic. And wouldn't you know it, we opened this up for 30 students, and within 24 hours, registration was full. So it showed us that demand was there, and they were absolutely amazing. They went out and did some really great projects at Natividad Creek Park. You can see a picture here of them as they graduated on the last day, final day of camp, very happy to receive their certificates, but hard at work renovating the horseshoe pits, which are now clear of weeds, well painted. We even work with our sign department to get new signs up on them. They worked in the dog park. They did a variety of activities out there, I think, to beautify Natividad Creek Park. We hope to maintain that program, but staffing always dictates that. But we certainly look forward to bringing back Yagi and our Youth Leadership Academy next year. And that's what we have for you. And so questions for Vivian or I, happy to take.
Is there, thank you, Jose and Vivian. Is there any other questions from any of the commissioners, or would you like to make a comment? Commissioner Ramirez.
So again, I think that this is a really great program, and that it highlights like a lot of things that you guys are doing for the community, especially for the teens and the youth. So my question is, the summer conditioning camp, who did you guys have, training the kids?
City employees, okay. City staff. We have we had recreation coordinators and assistants, and then some of our temporary staff.
Okay. Bringing into the picture of how you guys offered community service for the high schoolers, would it be possible to open up the summer conditioning, because I think that it's great and I think that it should stay, would it be possible to open it up to the players from the schools to be able to have them come in and show the kids skills as well?
We have done volunteer work with high schoolers before, and so normally what we do is usually it's a full-time employee or a part-time employee who are leading the camps. We have in the past, like I said, worked with the high schoolers, and we can have them come in and assist us, but this year, or this time around, we just focus on our full-time employees and part-time temporary employees. But it is a great suggestion, and so we can look at it going forward.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Any other commissioner? Commissioner Martinez.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Vivian. Thank you, Jose, for your presentation and for continuing this programming. I got flyers at the radio station from your programs and the summer programs too, and it really helps, and I want you guys to keep sending those to Radio Bilingue, like keep sending more, like every single thing. I want to see our community book full of library announcements, and I make sure when I get in, I go through and I put them on the top. And I was like, everybody read these on top, get the library, get us read, get us out there, get the word out to the community. But thank you all of you guys for everything that's been going on this past summer, and let's just keep up the good work.
Yeah. Again, thank you so much for everything. I know a lot of work goes into these programs. The kids themselves, again, my kids love them. The only thing, and this is just me being my sustainable self, is the use of single-use plastic in a lot of these kits. So that was my only thing to recommend, is if we can look at alternative ways to minimize that, you know, the Ziploc bags. And I it might be a COVID thing, but yeah, that was the only thing.
Is there any other questions from any other commissioners? Okay. Great presentation. Thank you so much. Good job. The only thing that I can comment on is that, you know, it's great to see that we're doing things, creative things, because I'm telling you, when I saw the Little Mermaid, with the firehouse where they put it, I mean, I shared it and I was like, oh, I'm gonna go get a packet, you know? It was so nice to see that we were doing this.
But going back to Commissioner Ramirez, it was a pleasure meeting you.
And I apologize for not having my mic on, but you're absolutely right on having more teen programs. I know the staff is working creatively to establish our leadership, because the leadership program that under your leadership, Jose and Vivian, is greatly missed, and it's a vital program for teens and preparing them to become leaders. So thank you for bringing that up, and I'm sure they're listening to us and they're gonna make things happen. And again, thank you so much to all of you. It's good seeing you again. And yeah, we've got to keep working for our community and our kids and our families. So going back to our agenda, if there's no other further, in Kristen's commissioner's report. I just gave my report. I think everybody's doing a great job. I just have one comment, and because we do want our families to get out to the parks and we want them to walk, and a lot of families are doing that. I go all over and I see people walking, which we want teens. A lot of teens are walking, except one thing, and I'm bringing it up in this commission, is that our restrooms need to be available to our community. So I'm bringing that up, that if we can please work on that. I just was in Seaside this weekend. I was going to some music thing, and I had never been to their park, that Laguna, I think it's called Laguna, by the Embassy Suites. Mm-hmm. I got off, nice park. A lot of signs were posted, like when the park closes at dusk, bathrooms were open, they were clean, they had a festival going on. And it was really nice to see the families out there. Everybody was wearing masks, by the way. I was very impressed, very impressed. And I want people, when they come to Salinas, that they say, Salinas has clean parks and they have bathrooms at work. And they're available for the community, right? So I leave you with that. And any other reports from the commissioners? And I just want to say, Albert, thank you so much for being chair for 2 years. Mm, we greatly appreciate your service. You know that.
Thank you. I know.
In the community. So thank you so much. Any other comments?
As far as District 1 goes, Natividad Creek Park looks amazing. Again, I see more and more families using the park. There's been constant cleanups that have helped, which is encouraging people to utilize our parks and our resources, so and attend those activities that you guys presented on. So good job.
I just have a little update on the tennis courts. Just wanted to let you guys know that there's a lot of activities. It's kind of extension of what the city's doing, because they did partner with YMCA, and we'll probably hear more from our director, Kristen, on that. Just wanted to let you know, I did have the pleasure of being a captain of a team recently, and it was only because I'm pretty good on computers. And I actually love tennis. It's a passion, but it's more for the exercise. And our team actually made it to the sectionals and playing to get into the nationals, and it was in Sacramento. We did okay, but we did not make it to go to national. But the it's interesting, because USTA put these programs together with league playing. On this league, it was like you had to be 19 years old, so I qualify. the oldest player on our team, actually, he's pretty young. He's 72, but they're gonna raise his rating, because he was like winning all his matches with his partner. And we have our youngest player is 19. And we have several players that are in their 20s, and it's an extension of when kids play in high school, then they have no place to go. They go to public parks and hopefully they get involved. But we have one player that's out there, and he's been only playing 3 years, but he's gotten so good that they're gonna raise him. He's 11-0 in our team, and they'll probably raise him. But anyway, I just wanna thank the city and Kristen and Commissioner Gloria De La Rosa. She was councilwoman helping to get Sherwood renovated, and that was really nice. And hopefully we can get all of our other parks taken care of, cleaned up, and beautify them, because I've been seeing a lot of new people in these parks. And in fact, I just got a text that there's a player from the University of North Carolina playing tennis on our courts at Sherwood. So it's interesting we're getting, and I see a lot of other players. There's a lady that actually, she was the champion in the country of Jordan out there. So, but now she has 3 children, but we're getting a lot of people active in our community. So I'm thankful for that. And thank everybody for supporting the parks.
Anyone else? Comment? Commissioner Martinez.
Yes, I just want to mention that here in District 3, we just had our Salinas Valley Food and Wine Festival, which was absolutely amazing. It was off the hook. Lots of people out, lots of businesses pouring, and business was open on the side businesses. Just the whole town was a buzz, and brought the community together with fun family times and music and food and activities, and it was just a great time and just a good boost to District 3.
So I visited a few parks recently. Specifically, I visited Hartnell Park, Natividad Creek Park, and then, I'm sorry, I'm not too familiar on what the park is in Hebron Heights. It's over there by Steinbeck.
Cesar Chavez,
okay. And I wanted to point out the lack in sustainable water fountains. So I don't know if the water fountains are off because of COVID or if the water pressure is severely low, but the only way that you'll be able to drink out of those water fountains is by putting your mouth on the actual faucet, and that's a horrible way to combat the current pandemic that we're in right now. And I guess like a best way to combat heat exhaustion, especially with the rising temperatures that we're experiencing right now because of summer, would be great to have more sustainable water fountains, especially for those people that can't afford to have reusable water bottles or water bottles in general. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. Is there anyone else? Commissioner Camacho? Okay. Well, this concludes our commissioner's reports, so director's report.
Thank you. I have a couple of things I want to mention, and then I'm going to turn it back out to the staff to talk about some of the things that we have coming up in the department. First, I'm so glad to hear you talk about parks and share some of your thoughts and concerns on how we can improve. One of the things we've seen across the department is a number of vacancies. I think across the department we have close to 18 vacancies between library, recreation, and parks. And so I'm working very in earnest with the HR department to get those recruitments open. Our park maintenance team, we have 6 current employees for 48 parks and close to 400 acres. So we have a number of recruitments open to get those filled, and that will help us to be able to be more responsive to some of the great suggestions that you've made today. So I wanted to let you know that. Also, we do have a number of staff that are onboarding and have started to onboard. So at the next commission meeting, we will certainly come and bring them before you so you get to see their faces, and we'll introduce them to you. So that's something to look forward to next month. I also wanted to let you know, if you've been by the Hebron Family Center recently, you will see that it is chain link fenced off. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we've been dealing with a lot of deferred maintenance in that facility for a number of years. You may recall probably 5 years ago-ish, we had some faulty electrical due to some storms, and we actually had to shut the building down for a couple of weeks, which is a huge impact to that neighborhood. Unfortunately, while we didn't get a lot of significant storms this past winter, we did have a couple, and it got to a point where it just was not safe. We have foundational issues And I just want to bring that up here in case you go by there and you see that it's fenced off. The building is closed. We've pulled staff out. Staff has done a great job to still reach out to that neighborhood, and we're doing food bank distributions in the parking lot. We're giving kits out at that location, and we'll continue to do that outreach to the neighborhood. We are very hopeful. Jose did over the last couple of years, has worked very hard on our Prop 68 applications. And you may be aware, 2 years ago, we applied for a Prop 68 grant to rebuild the Hebron Family Center. Unfortunately, we were not successful in receiving funding. However, our state parks rep advised us that it was a really great project. We had a lot of great pieces to it, and they suggested and encouraged that we reapply this year. So we have applied for Prop 68 again to rebuild the Hebron Family Center. We're hoping to hear in September-ish. They have, and Jose, when he gives his report, he can probably speak to the numbers a little bit better than me in terms of the total number of requests, the available funds, and what the requests that came in, what that totaled. It's a huge discrepancy between how much funding was requested and how much is available. But we're hopeful. In addition to the Hebron application, we also submitted a Prop 68 application for the Closter Park to completely do a renovation of Closter. So we're hopeful. We're keeping our fingers crossed with our partners at Big Sur Land Trust, who also submitted an application for Carr Lake. I think we all came to the table, recognized we could have some level of competition, but at the end of the day, we want to see funds come to Salinas. And so we're really hopeful. And so hopefully in September, we might be able to give some good news to the commission around that. And with that, I will go ahead and Jose, why don't you go first, and then we can go down the line with some of the things that are coming up.
Sure, I'll start off with the numbers that Kristen was referencing, and it actually got more competitive this year. There were more asks for the money, so there was actually more money available. So in the year we applied in 2019, the amount of funding available is like $254 million around there. This time around, it's actually been increased since we've applied. It's at $520 million. Fantastic. They received $4 billion worth of asks. So many, many times more available funding. They know the needs there. They're hoping, I think, to capitalize on the new money that's come to the state and hopefully continue this program. But this is the last round for this proposition. And so we're hoping to get in. They did come out and visit us, which they did not do last year. And so we got a chance to, Vivian, Kristen, and I showed them around both Hebron and Closter, because we've submitted two applications this year. So we're very hopeful that we will get some funding. We're not relying completely on that. I think Kristen's done a great job of advocating for both those projects through a variety of channels. And so we're hoping that something comes through, especially for Hebron with, that was our greatest fear, that site would have to go dark for a while. And unfortunately it did happen. The one bright side of that is it's happened during the pandemic where we haven't been open anyway. So the community hasn't felt it in the same way they might've had we been fully open. So that's my piece on there. So thank you, Kristen. I want to invite you all to our cleanup happening. If you have some trash around the neighborhood, around your home, come on out to Republic Services off of Madison Lane. It's a drive-through. You come on in and we'll help you unload and get all your trash out. There are some things you can't bring, like paints, tires, but most household trash, appliances, things like that you could bring. Load up your car, come on out. We'll be 9 to 12 this coming Saturday. We normally do these in the neighborhoods, but because of COVID, Republic's asked that they host them there at their site, which is their transfer station off of Madison Lane. So I'd like to invite you to that. Also like to invite you to like us on Facebook or Instagram, Neighborhood Services, the library page, Recreation. You'll get to hear about all these activities, but our cleanups have been ongoing. Since we started doing them around March, we've built a new database of over 200 active volunteers. We're very proud of that. We're gonna continue to offer. We're right now planning a really big series of cleanups for Make a Difference Day in October. So we're really excited about that. And we just have a really great, not just young adults, but a lot of adults and residents who are eager to help, who have been at our different cleanups over the past 4 or 5 months. And so it's a great opportunity to come on out, give back to your community, but follow us to learn about these opportunities on our Facebook or Instagram pages. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Elsa.
So on our sports end, we're currently taking registration for youth soccer. So it is geared towards pre-K through second grade. And so you can come on in Monday through Friday at the Salinas Recreation Center to sign up, or you can check us out online at Civic Rec. You can find the link on our city website under our page. If not, you can always call our office for more information, and we can definitely help anybody who's looking to register.
Is this working? Okay, I'll do it from here. So on the library side, we are preparing for a lot of our fall programs. A lot of our adult literacy classes are picking up. We had orientations for computer literacy classes, which go from beginner to intermediate to advanced. And we have some of those happening in person and virtually as well. Our citizenship classes are starting up again for those looking to get their citizenship. They get help with the questions, with the application process, with questions they might have with that. We're also providing tutoring assistance for adults, those that are looking to get their high school equivalency, also known as GED. So if they need to study, need help with specific subjects, they could get the help from staff and volunteers. And for those, we offer drop-in options and also one-on-one tutoring that they can schedule with their tutors to accommodate their time. We're also restarting some of our parent and child play groups, which is a program that's been funded by First Five for at least 8 years. And it's really to engage parents in them learning how they can become their kids' first teacher. So it's a program geared for 0 to 5 parents and children. And it's a 20-week program that they commit to participating. So we have 4 of those groups starting, and hopefully we'll add another 2 or 3 in the next couple months. And then fall programming for youth, we're preparing to get that going in the fall, really taking and learning what worked well, what didn't during the summer, and bringing that forward into the fall. We hope to have a combination of both in-person, virtual, and hybrid of potentially both of those continuing in the fall. We know that parents, students, and administrators need time to settle for the new school year, so we'll likely be launching those early September. And that also includes some of our after-school homework centers, which we host at 3 different school sites, and also at our Cesar Chavez Library. So we're trying to work with educators and the guidelines that are ever-changing to make sure that we offer safe but also meaningful relationships between our youth. A lot of times our tutors are either college students, high school students, and some staff that have been around for a while. To kind of build those connections, but also help kids as they're going through in-person schooling now. And then, you know, a lot of adult literacy classes are the educational side, but hopefully we hope to keep the adult kits happening, maker kits. Something we want to do is try to utilize some of the makerspace equipment that we have in El Gavilan. So utilizing our 3D printer, our laser cutter, all the other nice equipment that we have there is to let our community take advantage of it. And then we're continuing, we're hoping to re-engage some of our partners that we worked in previous years to try to get programming going. We try to re-engage through some of them through summer. You know, they're all going through staffing challenges, different challenges that we know happen because of staffing and health and safety, et cetera. So we hope to re-engage some of those community partners, Small Business Association, Artist Sync. We started planning a few programs that didn't go through. So hopefully re-engage those kind of pre-planned programs that we had in the past to maybe bring them back again in the fall or in the spring. And that's all I got for the library.
Good evening, Commissioner. So just a few more things from the library on the service side. I want to remind everyone that we're currently at the library is running our Read Away Fines campaign, in which anyone who has any fines or fees on their account, they can remove them by reading. So every day that they read, we'll remove $5 of fines on their account, and there's no limit of what kind of fines or the amount. As long as you read, you can get your fines, you know, removed from the account. So that program will be running until the end of August, and we hope a lot of people will take advantage of it and start September and the new school year with a Clear Library account. So we also want to use this opportunity to encourage everyone to come visit the library. All of our locations are open for 5 days out of the week for each location, but we are open from Monday through Saturday with different schedules. Additionally, especially at El Gavilan Library, one of the features of that building is the study rooms. So this month we started to reopen the study rooms, and we have a self-serve reservation program that's available through our website. So anyone who needs to use the study rooms during the library open hours, they can just reserve it online, come to the library and use it. But yeah, we're excited to welcome the community back into the library. Thank you.
Nope, that's it. Okay, thank you very much to all the staff for your presentation and presentations. Any other commissioners before we end our meeting? Any comments, any questions before we leave? Commissioner Martinez.
I'm just going to remind everybody, once again, thank you all for presenting right now. You know, we at Radio Bilingo, we have a fully produced PSA on the fines forgiveness. And I'm also reading, you know, I'm reading on the computer literacy and the advanced and the intermediate programs and stuff like that. I want all announcements from all your programs and your signups and your hiring. I want to see our community book full of what the library and the parks have going on, because our radio station really is a lifeline to a lot of these out of reach and underserved families and communities. Mm-hmm. So get me that stuff at the station so we can actually produce more PSAs. All right, thank you.
Well, good point. Thank you, Commissioner Martinez. So we're adjourned, and thank you so much, and have a nice evening and be safe. Thank you to all the commissioners. Thank you.